Happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving.
What do you think of when you hear that word, Thanksgiving? What's the first thing that comes to your mind?
Joy.
Joy?
Thankful.
Huh?
Thankful.
Okay. Well, the kids said turkey, right? Turkey. Some of us might say, I thought I'd get it, football, right? We didn't get that. That could be. Some of us may have said recliner. Some of us may have said Alka-Seltzer. In fact, I have a, someone as a joke brought me a Rolaids dispenser, and I have it on my shelf. Occasionally people mention that when they come in my office. But you know, the day after Thanksgiving is a number two day for acid relief products. And you can probably guess number one, Super Bowl Sunday, of course, right? So we can't miss that Thanksgiving is a spiritual opportunity amid all the other things that we enjoy and that we do on that day, and that remind us about that day. And the thing that I hope that I can give to you today is an appreciation for the power of an attitude of gratitude. The power of grabbing a hold of the gift of thankfulness in your life, because it does have power. This is the reason that the idea of thankfulness was central to almost every ancient religious practice. The Native Americans used to gather in certain places at certain times of year to celebrate and to give thanks and to record what they had done and what they had received. Seven times throughout the year, the people of Israel had to gather together to celebrate. They gathered together to have a feast day. And three times every single day. So I want you to have a spirit of thankfulness every day. That's what Paul says, right? Rejoice in the Lord always. So I want you right now to turn to someone near you and say, I am thankful every day. Can you do that for a moment? Just turn to somebody and say, I am thankful every day.
And you?
We set our intentions. We have to be intentional about thankfulness. We have to be observant. And we have to look around to realize all of the things, all the many things that will always go beyond our awareness that we have to be thankful for. I used to bring in the log for the children's sermons. How many want the log to come back? I'll tell you a strong one. Hiding behind the rail over there. Comes out on special occasions when I can talk about a tree or wood or something. But they don't come back. There was this thing where somebody carved a face on it for me. Somebody else put hair on it. And then someone gave me a little ribbon for the top of the log. It was a little black. It was kind of like those rubber bands, you know, you get around your wrist that say something, you know, for something. And the saying on it said, check your head. Check your head. And I discovered that she got it off of a bunch of broccoli in the grocery store. It was intended for the people who work at the grocery store. But it's also something that we ought to say about ourselves every day, right? Check your head. What are you thinking about? Are you thankful? Are you grateful? And this is so important in 12-step recovery programs. And they actually have five steps to an attitude of gratitude. And the first is to make it a part of your mindset. You have to be intentional, and you have to have in your head that this is the key to living a joyful life. The second is also very important, to appreciate simple things. to be aware of things that maybe ordinarily you're not, and to be grateful for them. The third is to make a journal of the things that you're thankful for. Maybe that can be part of your spiritual celebration of Thanksgiving. Number four is very important. Do something for others. And number five, this also is very hard for a lot of us, embrace your own imperfections. How do we, you know, we can't be thankful because something's not right, you know? Say, I would like to be thankful, but I can't because, but you have to embrace your imperfections. It's good advice. And gratefulness in the recovery process is the key to success. Without gratitude, you'll never find a sense of satisfaction in life. It helps us to enjoy life more fully. And that's what Paul's telling the Philippians in our passage here today. The same thing. He's saying, check your head, Euodia and Syntyche. Develop an attitude of gratitude. Stop complaining and being critical about everything. Because complaining and being critical are not going to get you where you want to be. And he says in verse 6, very clearly, do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Now this is the inner part, right? It's a part where we worry about things and we get distracted. We aren't thankful. But then he goes on in verse 9, and he's got the outer things. He says, keep on doing the things that you've learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. These are, I think, the two important things about Thanksgiving, and the two things that we can give you in a spiritual way. The first is, it's too bad if we limit Thanksgiving to one day a year, because really it's an every day of year practice. In order for us to have good spiritual health, we have to remember that all these virtues are kind of aggregates, aren't they? Mindfulness, appreciation, joy, enjoyment. They all have to do with having Thanksgiving and being thankful. And it begins with us, and it begins with our head. But second, he says you have to do something, like in the 12-step process. Do something for others. We have to get outside of ourselves. And the thing that's really too bad is that often in communities like ours, generosity is during the holiday seasons. And we're aflush with food now. We had a special meal last night for people in the community. I mean, there's another one tonight. There's one on Monday. But what happens the rest of the year? We have to extend thankfulness. And the way we act out of generosity throughout the whole year. Because of course it's going to be here. People will be satisfied over the holidays. But we have to make it a practice throughout the year. In many ways that go beyond the things that we've been doing now. There's a Jesuit priest who works on community action. His name is John Deere. And he said, the life of peace is an inner journey toward a disarmed heart, and a public journey toward a disarmed world. Today in psychology, there has been an intense study now on the science of happiness. You may have seen some of that around. It used to be in the early days of psychology, it was all about what's wrong, you know, and we looked at the abnormal psychology. But today, psychology is beginning to move in a positive direction, and there are more and more people who are looking at healthiness. And what it is that we need to do to have a joyful life and a meaningful life. And Martin Seligman has done a lot of that research and a lot of the studies on what makes people happy. Now the first thing is that you have to have the basic necessities of life in order to be happy. Food, water, and housing. And if you don't have those things, your chance of happiness in life aren't very good. So that's why we need to make a commitment to helping people to have some of those bases so that everyone has an opportunity for the pursuit of happiness. We We've even coined a new word today. It's not called, we don't talk about hunger. We talk about food insecurity, which means that a family actually has to worry about whether they're going to have food on the table at some point over the month. And we know that 20% of children in the United States live in homes where there is food insecurity, where their parents run out of money before the end of the month, and they live in a situation where they have anxieties about how they're going to care for their children. We also live in a world where, this is an amazing statistic, but has panned out in many different studies, that with as many homeless people as we have in America, the reality is that there are 6 empty houses in America for every single homeless person. So it's not that we don't have the resources. It's that we have to develop the will and the gratitude to be about these things. And I might add that 30 to 40% of all homeless people are veterans, are military veterans. When we were in Biloxi, Mississippi, we worked on a great project where Back Bay Mission is creating apartments for homeless veterans. And opportunities like that are a way we can do something for other people. Martin Seligman has identified the things that do make for happiness. The following things increase happiness levels: meaningful, close relationships, a positive, optimistic frame of mind, accepting responsibility for your life, being engaged in meaningful work, living in the present, and practicing an altruistic life, including gratitude, forgiveness, and compassion. Now, what I want to point out is that our spiritual traditions have been doing that for thousands of years, right? Isn't that the point of the whole thing? For us to become mindful, to become aware of what we have. You know, one of the problems we have in the world today is everything runs by money. Everything runs by gross national product. But what if we looked at the goal of life differently? What if we looked at the goal of a nation not as the standard of living, but in how well we create joy in the people who live there? What if nations adopted as their goal to create joy for everyone that was a part of that nation? What can we learn from these spiritual traditions about creating joy? It would mean we would do those two things. We would have it in our head and in our heart and in our hands. And at the end of our service today, we're going to sing the great song, "Now Thank We All Our God." And there's a line in that: with heart and hands and voices. Don't worry about anything, Paul says, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. We've got to check our head, it's inner. And he said for the outer, keep on doing the things that you've learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you.